this afternoon we are gathered together as one God's family. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, in the communion of the Holy Spirit, be with you all.
And with your spirit.
So, brothers and sisters, this afternoon we gathered to celebrate the Eucharist to our sister Elizabeth. And during this celebration, let us ask God to grant eternal life and to comfort us in our sorrow. At the death, only God can help us. So let us turn to God now, whose love accompanies us at every step of life's journey. And so to prepare ourselves to celebrate this funeral, let us acknowledge our sins and failures and ask God to forgive us. Lord, you are slow to anger and rich in mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You redeem our life from the grave. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Your love for us is everlasting. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, whose nature are always to forgive and to show mercy, we humbly implore you for your servant Elizabeth, whom you have called, and since she hoped and believed in you, grant that she may be led to our true homeland, to delight in its everlasting joy. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, our Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated to listen to the word of God.
Because grace and mercy are upon his holy ones, and he watches over his elect. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Responses: The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake, even though I walk through the darkest valley. I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
Lord,
the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
The Lord
is my
shepherd, I shall not want.
Revelation. Then I, John, saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among humans. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water as a gift, from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be his God, and he will be my son." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Use of grace. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And I go to prepare, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated for a moment. So this afternoon, we will gather to worship God and to commend the soul of our sister Elizabeth in the Lord to God's never failing mercy. Today we also gather to give thanks for the moments Elizabeth shared with us, and to share those memories with each other for after this funeral mass. So our gospel reading today is one of the most chosen by families and friends for funerals taken from John 16, verse 1 to 6. Maybe because it touches upon their feeling experience. Jesus talked about finding peace for troubled hearts, about trusting in Christ, and about finding the way home. And the context is that Jesus is saying goodbye to his closest friends, an opportunity we would all like to have before death comes. And Jesus' word to them is this word to all of us. Let not your hearts be troubled. You have trust in God, trust also in me. So with this encouragement, he reminds us to have faith, real faith, that rallies our spirit to accept the reality of death. Death is real. Whether we like it or not, we will all die. And the difference between Elizabeth and us, Jesus died ahead of us. But we will all die. That's why in the death of Elizabeth, let us accept that his death with faith. Because death is a reality. And that even facing death, there is still nothing to be afraid. We should not be afraid of death. But some people are afraid of death. Why? Maybe because they are not yet prepared. So, if you are really prepared when you die, so nothing to be afraid of. And how do we prepare? Simple. We live today in a good Christian life. According to the Jewish spirituality, there are only three things to do. First is prayer. Second is doing good works. And the third is doing fasting. So prayer is necessary. We must be a man of prayer. I don't know if you know how to pray. We need to pray. It is because without God, we can do nothing. Everything comes from God. All the gifts and blessings that we enjoy now, it really comes from God. So we need to pray for grace. And prayer is nothing else than a personal conversation between you and God alone. And how do we pray? We must first to praise and adore God, first and foremost, because He's the one who created us, who creates us. And God is not, because of His power and omnipotence. So this is the first thing that we should do, prayer of adoration, because, you know, He is the most powerful. Second is to ask to pray, to ask for forgiveness, because human as we are also subject to limitation and corruption. That's why we commit sin. And that, but by the sin, we ask for forgiveness. And forgiveness in order that we should be free from sin and death. And then, another prayer is to thank God for all the blessings that we receive. I know that you have your lots of gifts that you receive, materially, spiritually, morally, that we have to thank the Lord always. And the last one is to pray for all your needs. So this is very simple, prayer. And we should always find ourselves to pray. Some people say that they have no time to pray because of their job, because of their business, because of their works. But we can also make your works as a prayer. If you only are doing your work, offer this, offer that to God. So prayer. Second is good works. We are all good, but relatively good. But how do you know that we are good? Just help others, those who are in need. And be always have your time to help those who are in need. So good works, so that we can have this merit. We can have this grace, we receive grace from God. And then fasting is to discipline ourselves, not only bread that man need, but also the word of God. So this is three things: prayer, good works, and fasting. So it is that we have to prepare. So in our brief intro, more than ever, believe in God. We should believe in God. That God, that there is really God. Believe that you are never alone in our anxieties in life. That you can always go to Him as a loving Father. And that even when you forget Him, He is there seeking you out because God loves you. He loves us so much. And the reason why we love us all, we love them also because it is Him who loves us first. And that even you forget Him, He is always there. Now, through Jesus has shown His disciples a trust in God, our Father. He is about to take the lesson to take next level in our journey to the cross. Where I am going, you cannot follow. I go to prepare a place for you. My Father's house, there are many dwelling places. And if it were not so, would I have told you, I go to a place to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. I know you know the way to the place where I am going. So Jesus prepared us a place for all of us, and the place that He will prepare is no other than heaven. That's why Jesus is the way to heaven. Jesus is our life in order to possess eternal life. He is the truth that we have to believe in. So Jesus tells us that the Father's will is that we will, that we find a home in our Father's house. Jesus' work is to go and prepare a place for us. Jesus says, He will come and take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. So it's very, you are so lucky. If when you die, you will be united in heaven, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. There will be no suffering, no pain, but all our tranquility and happiness. Home is a place of love and happiness. That's why Jesus called heaven our home. Home is a place of cheer and fellowship, of sharing good times and old times. That's why Jesus called heaven our home. That is our destiny. So aspire to go to heaven so that you can experience eternal happiness. Home is a place of love and forgiveness, where people wait for you with open arms. Home is a place where wounds are healed and hearts are mended. Home is a place of embrace and kisses and smile and joy. That is why Jesus called heaven our home. This is the place that Jesus has prepared for us, a home in the bosom of the Father. One day, our home will become a new heaven in a new earth. We will be raised from the dead to live with no more suffering and death. We will come home and walk and talk with Jesus face to face. Today, we will say goodbye to Elizabeth, and we pray that she may take her rest and be at home with all the faithful departed and our Lord Jesus Christ in His Father's home. May she rest in peace. Please all rise. Prayers of the faithful. God, the Almighty Father, raised Christ, His Son, from the dead. With confidence, we ask Him to save His people, living and dead. Let our response be, Lord, hear our prayer. Blessed are you, Lord, Brother of Christ, unto your goodness we have received. The bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and not of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord, Father of creation, the goodness we have received. The wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed
be God. We have our spirit for death, and we accept the sacrifice in our service, and we please it to your care. Lord, we shall give an intake as we have sin. Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our mighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, to praise the Lord of his name, for our good and for the honest church.
Let's all rise. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant, Elizabeth, we beseech your mercy that she who did not doubt your son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty, our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, mighty eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of death, of blessed resurrection has come, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed and ended, and when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with the angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glorious without end, we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the Father of our holiness. Make holy, therefore, this gift, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed, he himself and entered willingly into his passion. He took bread and giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith, when we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of the Lord's death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partake of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, and all other Archbishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant Elizabeth, whom you have called today, from this world to yourself. Grant that she who was united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also, brothers and sisters, who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy will come back to the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and all the saints, who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and we praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, the Redeemer, the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. At the Savior's command and formed by the divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by that of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ, for the kingdom of God, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. May this be a reminder for our discussion and God's perspective. Love of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Love of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Love of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us. Lord, we are not worthy that you should enter and live in the world. But on the same word, in my soul shall be healed. Let's look at the communion. moment, you'll be just accept the blessing. Just cross your hand and bow and receive the blessing from the priest. nor God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body, food for the journey, mercifully grant that strengthened by it, our sister Elizabeth may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Final recommendation. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister Elizabeth. May our farewell express our affection for her. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet her again, when the love of Jesus Christ, which conquers all things, destroys heaven, even death itself. In baptism, Elizabeth shared in the death and resurrection of Christ. May she be welcomed into the glory of eternal life. So into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our sister Elizabeth in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will raise him with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessing which you bestowed upon her in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us to remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our sister forever. Amen. Now please be seated to listen to the eulogy given to the family.
Lunch will be at Boston Pizza on Manitoba Street following the internment, and anyone not attending the internment may just gather at the restroom. On behalf of the family, we would like to thank everyone for their kind messages of sympathy. Thank you for being with us in person or virtually to celebrate the life of Elizabeth Martin. My name is Susan Twemlow, or Susie, and she was my dear aunt and godmother. My mother, Nick, was her sister. And it is my honor to deliver this message to you today. Elizabeth was known to many as Liz, but our branch of the family knew her affectionately as Libby. Elizabeth was born in Rockland Hospital on May 12, 1937, the only one of her 11 siblings to be born in a hospital. Her parents were Angeline and Albert Tuda. The family lived on their homestead 4 kilometers west of Lazoo. Her family, like many others during that time, did not have much. They worked hard on their farm to provide for their needs. Aunt Libby started school 4 kilometers from home, walking every day until it turned cold, after which her father would drive her in a sleigh pulled by horse. Later, when her father passed away, her mother and remaining siblings moved to Olench. While attending school and Libby worked during her school lunch hours and after school at a local restaurant, and she made 25 cents an hour. Determined to do something special and make a difference, she decided to become a nurse. In 1955, she went into nurse's training at the Providence Hospital in Moose Jaw. While she was there, in the first year of training, she made a mere $6 a month, $8 in her second year and $12 in her third year. That money was used to buy her nylons, caps, and gowns for work. Whenever possible, her mother would send food to her by mail. She graduated with her registered nurse's diploma in 1958. In 1959, while working in the psychiatric unit at the hospital, she met Owen Martin, who was working there as well. They were married the following year on August 15, 1959. In the years following, Owen and Libby had three children, Lori, David, and Denise. When we were growing up, it was always a special day when we got to come up to Moose Jaw for the day or overnight. My mom, Monique, and Libby would catch up while we kids played or went to a park for swimming or to the drive-in, and if we were lucky, we got to go to McDonald's or Dairy Queen for a treat. We would also get to go shopping. Aunt Libby was an expert shopper. She knew just where to go to find what we needed, as she had things scoped out before we got there. Our aunt was a very generous person. She always knew just what others needed. She would shop all year, remember stuff, and watch when it was on sale and pick it up. She would save the items to give for a birthday or Christmas gift. She also did not want your siblings to go without, so there was always a little gift or treat bag for the others in your family. She also loved the opportunity to shop for a special occasion. She loved the challenge of finding just the right dress, matching shoes, and the purse to complete the outfit. Although we used to get a little nervous when she was driving in the city, because she was quite the aggressive driver. If any of you have ever been a passenger with her, you will understand what I'm talking about. On one particular driving excursion, Aunt Libby was driving a standard car. Perhaps it was her Ford Pinto or Mercury Capri. She was driving down the street, engine revving, when a kid on the street yelled at her, "Shift, lady, shift!" Although she did not mind driving in the city, Aunt Liz hated driving on gravel roads in the country. But even though the majority of us lived on farms, she would venture out despite her fears. An even larger fear of hers was driving dirt roads in the rain. On many occasions, as soon as she would come down and make the rounds visiting us, it would rain. She would become very shaken, thinking she would never get home, so she just had to leave right away. Her brothers-in-law and nephews who farmed absolutely loved it when she visited because, of course, they needed a rain. There were a few times when a tractor was needed or another experienced driver would help her get on her way. So needless to say, all her farming relatives loved when she visited, if only to be able to give her a good-natured teasing. They found it quite easy to get a rise out of her. Besides muddy roads, another of her fears was snakes. They absolutely terrified her. One day, her kids were out playing with the others in the neighborhood. They would often play in the coulee behind their street. On this particular day, Aunt Libby was sleeping after working late night, so the kids decided to collect garter snakes. They collected about 14 in a pail and brought them home and dumped them onto the front lawn. Shortly afterward, Aunt Liz woke up and looked out the window, only to see her lawn curling with snakes. She immediately called Owen at work, and he proceeded to hurry home from work, which he never did. The kids got scared, gathered up all the snakes, they thought, and ran to put them back in the coulee. It turned out they had missed one, which their dad saw, and then had faced the punishment from him for scaring their mother and making him come home from work. Elizabeth was not the kind of person who sat still much. Besides having a full-time job and raising her family, she loved to cook and bake. Particularly if it was a special occasion. She would create a feast of turkey, ham, potatoes, gravy, vegetables, and salads. Not only was there a giant meal, there would be pies, and not just one kind of pie. She would make everyone their favorite kind. At one meal, there would be raisin, cherry, Saskatoon, or apple. There were also brownies, bundt cakes, squares, and lemon poppy seed cake. The food she was prepared was amazing and endless. We never walked away hungry. She would also often send some home with us as well. She took exceptional pride in making her meal special using her china, crystal, and good silver, even though we had to wash it all by hand because it could not go in the dishwasher. Aunt Louie absolutely loved her brothers and sisters. Family was so important to her. If there was an opportunity to host or visit, plans were made. They spent as much time as they could together. They would pick Saskatoons and choke cherries, travel to visit another family member or attend a wedding or anniversary. In the later years, they would get together to celebrate birthday. They loved to play cards or tile rummy. There are always many stories about growing up together, sometimes a little disagreement, and a few bottles of wine were consumed. The more wine, the louder the laughter. Elizabeth's favorites were Matus, Manchettes, and Baby Duck. She would also pull out her ice cream pails of her famous slush. Along with all the cooking, raising kids, working, and visiting, Aunt Libby always had a clean house, beautiful flower beds, fruit trees, and a garden. Her favorite hobby had to be sewing. Lori and Denise had matching dresses made for Christmas, weddings, or other celebrations. Even a few of us nieces had matching dresses, same pattern, different fabric, with matching floppy hats for the wedding of a cousin. As us girls went into Barbie dolls, she would make piles and piles of Barbie doll clothes for us. Later, she made Cabbage Patch doll clothes. Sadly, once her back started giving her trouble, she had to give up sewing. We were the lucky ones to have an aunt so loving and thoughtful. We all know how much Aunt Libby loved animals. She has always had dogs or a cat or both around. The term fur baby certainly applied to her. They provided her with comfort and companionship. Liz was an excellent nurse. She adored her work and was every bit a professional. She was efficient, organized, and treated her patients with care and compassion. She absolutely loved babies, and after all years in the profession, she would still be excited to hold those little babies. She was one of a kind. Aunt Libby noted that at the end of her career, which spanned 44 years, she was now delivering babies whose grandparents she had delivered so many years ago. The thing that stands out most in my mind about her was that in those times when she, her nieces, or family members were having a baby, she was sure that she was to be with us in the delivery room, even if she had the day off or spent the night already at work. She had to be by our sides, making sure we were safe and cared for. Elizabeth's later working years were complicated because of health issues. She retired on May 31st, 2002. She finally was able to do a bit of relaxing and spending time with her sisters, children, and grandchildren. Upon her retirement, after being a nurse for 44 years, she was acknowledged as being the nurse with the second most service hours in our province. Uncle Owen passed away on June 23rd, 2006. In 2010, Aunt Libby suffered a mild stroke. A few years later, she settled at the Grassline Health Center in Rockland, moving in just down the hall from her oldest sister, Corrine. Forever being the nurse in charge, our aunt would supervise the nurses in Rockland. She would keep an eye on them when they went on coffee break. If anyone stayed in the coffee room a little too long, she would tell them that their 20-minute coffee break was now over. It was time to get back to work. At other times, if someone on staff at Grassland was not doing something correctly, she would simply tell them, "You don't need to come back tomorrow." Almost everyone who worked at the home was fired by Aunt Libby during her 7 years there, except the one nurse trained by her in Moose Jaw. Our wonderful Elizabeth loved and adored her children and grandchildren. She loved to babysit and spend time with her family. She cared so much there was nothing she would not do to help them out. She is survived by her daughter Lori, husband Eugene, grandchildren Juliet, Robert, and Jenna, her son David, wife Donna, grandchildren Danara, husband Dan, Devin, and Desiree, her daughter Denise, husband Elmer, grandchildren Kristen, her husband Lee, and Dylan. She is also survived by her great-grandchildren, Rachel, Dalton, Otis, Esme, Eleanor, Sequoia, Cameron, Grady, Xander, and River. In addition, her brother-in-law Jack and wife Georgette Martin and sister-in-law Terry with her husband Jim Hunt. She also leaves numerous nieces and nephews. Elizabeth is the last of her 11 siblings to pass away. May she rest in peace and be reunited with all those who have gone before her. In closing, I would like all of us to consider the life and legacy of Elizabeth Martin. She was a strong, resilient, determined, and loving lady. She would have wanted us to remember her, but not with tears in our eyes or sadness in our hearts. She would want us to think of her and smile.
Please all rise. Dear friends, may every mark of affection and every gesture of friendship that you give to others be a sign of God's peace for you. In peace, let us take our sister Elizabeth to her place of rest.